Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today is a man who maybe is the epitome of the curse, may you live in interesting times. My guest is Luis J. Rodriguez. His book is called It Calls You Back, An Odyssey Through Love, Addiction, Revolutions, and Healing. It's published by Touchstone Books. Welcome, Luis.
Well, my pleasure. I appreciate this.
Thank you. And as I say, may you live in interesting times. You have definitely lived in interesting times.
Well, thank you so much. I guess it's a good thing to be able to say, I'm here. I made it. Yeah.
Yeah. But I'm still here, as the Steven Sondberg show goes.
Yeah.
But let's start with early Luis.
Yeah.
Brought up where?
In South Central LA and East LA. And I ended up in the streets early on, stealing, fighting, disturbing the peace, causing problems, got into gangs early on, got into drugs. Gangs when I was 11, drugs when I was 12.
With the gang, you had to join, didn't you, really?
Yeah.
And I mean, yeah.
At 11 years old, you're very developmentally not there as a kid. But what I saw was that the gang had power, I thought. Some respect, and I was a broken down, dumb kid, and it made sense for me to be in a gang. I don't know why, I thought it was the greatest thing there was.
Yeah, and if you were in a gang, didn't that also lead into the drugs?
The drugs was there, and I fell into it. And the funny thing, because not everybody in a gang is on drugs, but I just ate it up. I don't know why. I did sniffing pills, drinking. I had heroin. Heroin ended up getting rid of all the other drugs. I became a heroin addict.
Yeah. What about what happened at school then?
Yeah, well, at school, I was a very smart kid. I loved to learn. I hated school. I had a hard time with authority. I had a hard time with just being around people. And so school wasn't good for me for some reason. And I just didn't do very well in school.
Luis, it seemed you had a hard time with authority all along the way. When were you able to really break it?
I think it took a while leaving the gang life, and then I realized that, you know, I had turned my life over to gangs and drugs, to other things. It took a while for me to accept that I had to own my life and start turning my life over to myself.
Yeah.
And that it's really hard, because when you're in gangs, you give gang everything. They wanted me to shoot people, stab people, I'd do it. When you're on drugs, what does it want? It wants you to be there all the time. So finally owning my life was the battle, when I began to see that I had to have my own authority so then I can accept the authority of others, you know.
It seemed too that when you fell in love with Camilla,
that
was maybe the beginning of what would be a new way of life. Except as you say, there you were the day before the wedding and she's upset about bridesmaid dresses or something. Now you're there at the civil service.
Yeah.
And the priest is saying, listen, I got 10 other people in back of you waiting to get in.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Well, that's when I had my first doubts about that. I fell in love with the most beautiful, smartest girl I ever met. And I was fortunate to be with her, but it really wasn't love. You know what I'm saying? I was very immature.
Yeah.
I didn't know. And then my doubts right at that moment. It's like, well, maybe I should have waited, you know. But you can't stop it. It's already happening, you know.
Yeah. And then, of course, you had two children with her.
Yeah.
And one is your son.
My son, Ramiro.
Ramiro, and then your daughter, Andrea.
And to me, I have to say, they were life-saving to have in my arms, to see them born. It really changes a messed up person like me. I say messed up because, again, I was addictive, I had rage issues, but the beauty of holding them was transformative. It just wasn't totally transformative. It didn't do all at once. It took a while for me to finally get what it meant.
But you do put in this book, you at your worst, when you were there babysitting them, in essence, and you said you threw Ramiro against the wall.
One of the dumbest, most cowardly things I've ever done.
Yeah.
And I was drunk. I was mad at Camila. We had broken up. I was mad at the world. You know, the bad thing about what it calls you back is those rages, that anger, the trauma you had, but you still get triggered and you don't even know how or why.
Yeah.
That's what I think is important, is that people can leave that life, but they got to be aware of what will bring them back, little things, small moments. Mm-hmm. And that moment when I threw my son against the wall, a moment of madness, that when I, at the same time, I realized what a what am I doing? Yeah. But still, those moments happen to people.
Yeah. You know? I mean, because you said it was never the same with him again. And then as I read further in the book about him, I wondered, how did that play back within him when he got involved with the gangs himself and ended up in jail?
You know, I think the issue with him was that I never was there for him. I broke that bond just that moment, yeah. But then that I wasn't around. I neglected my two oldest kids. So when he came to stay with me, he was 13 years old, he was very resentful.
Yeah.
I couldn't quite get how bad and deep that was, how resentful he was, and I really couldn't be his dad. I tried, you know, I tried to do what I yeah. could. Couldn't stop him from the gang. I did what I could, couldn't stop him. Couldn't stop him from doing that yeah. life that I was, that all I could leave to see him fall into the same traps.
Yeah. It was interesting about the gangs because in some ways they could have sucked you back in yeah. and you would have been in jail yourself.
Sure.
But they sort of saw you because you had been starting to be involved with the Chicano movement.
Right. I became active in the community. I was somebody that they saw loved books, was different. I love art. But being an activist, in those days, 40 years ago, they could give you a pass. They could yeah. say, hey, you know what, this is not your life. Go on.
Yeah.
Nowadays, you can't do that.
It isn't
oh,
that
no,
way
no,
today.
No, these kids, when they get involved, nobody's going to tell them, go on. I was fortunate that I still had a time where, and I don't want to say these guys were the greatest in the world, but at least they were men of their word.
Yeah.
That was the one thing I could say about
yeah.
them.
And then, of course, Bethlehem Steel. Yeah. I mean, it was funny. You'd walk in, you'd work for a few months, you'd walk out, and then you'd go back in again.
I know. It was constant back and forth. The whole industry was changing, as you
yeah.
know. People were getting unemployed back and forth. It finally all died. Bethlehem
yeah.
Steel is gone. The National Lead Plant I worked at, St. Regis is gone. All the auto plants, aerospace. LA used to be the largest manufacturing center in the country, and it's almost all gone.
Yeah. You were aware, too, of the, I mean, to me, I don't see any color, but yeah. in the city, evidently, you know, when you come from another city, as
yeah.
I did back east,
yeah.
I never knew what they were talking about when they talked about Chicanos and
oh, yeah,
there was
yeah.
a difference. If you're not brought up in it, there's none so innocent as those who don't know.
Yeah, it's kind of like another world, self-contained.
Yeah.
They were the children and generations of the first Mexican immigrants that came after the Mexican Revolution.
Yeah.
And that was a very traumatic experience, but once they were here, they felt discriminated, they felt pushed aside. The Pachuco gangs came out in the
yeah.
30s and 40s. We were like the generation of, since the Pachucos, the Cholos that we were in the
yeah.
50s, 60s, and 70s. And we were the kids that just didn't feel that we belonged. We were
yeah.
constantly not integrated in the world.
Yeah.
And the gangs served as a place for us to feel some sense of power when you felt powerless.
Yeah. Because if you don't teach a child how to read properly, they're not going to know how to grow.
They're not. And I had one good thing, is I love to read. That's
yeah.
the one saving grace I had, because I didn't know English very well, and I learned by reading books.
Yeah.
And I mentioned in my book how Chartered to Web was like my favorite book.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but that was really a good thing for me, because a lot of my friends didn't have books and didn't want books. I really love books.
Yeah. And with Camila, am I pronouncing it correct?
Yeah, we say Camila.
Camila.
Yeah, yeah.
The two of you worked as a couple, though, with these
yeah.
conventions, with the getting
we
the groups together.
We were active together, and there was a
yeah.
point where I think that if we stayed, maybe like in Pasadena, where we were really good,
yeah.
maybe if we stayed there, we probably would have been more or less fine. We were moving around to be part of all this stuff, and it was taking a toll on us. And I didn't realize it till later, you know, that we were
yeah.
just probably moving around too much. We should have stayed in one community, worked there, and just made the most of it. Because
yeah.
there was that point where me and her worked very well
yeah.
with our babies, and it was me and her active yeah. with youth and everything. It was nice.
Because I kept saying, why do they keep moving? Because, you know, there's always the tension of moving.
Yeah.
yeah.
Oh, it's really a lot. It's almost hassle. Money, and then you're moving from one poor neighborhood to another one. You're not really living really well, and it's just one worse neighborhood than the one before. It's like, man. And we went back and watched, which was fine for me. I spent time when I was a kid and watched, but it really was too much for her. It was too much away from our families. It was a lot of strain that I didn't know about at the
yeah.
time.
But meanwhile, Luis Rodriguez is starting to write and go sort of like to night college, and then
yeah.
you have a wonderful man,
yeah.
a Japanese teacher,
yeah.
who taught you journalism.
It was really
when
great.
They wanted to cancel the class because you were the only kid who showed up.
I had to honor people like that. Mr. Takagi, who made the effort to stay for this one kid. He didn't owe me nothing. Yeah. He must have seen something, and he stood the whole time. Yeah. And he also helped me get into a summer program for minority journalists at UC Berkeley.
Yeah.
He wrote me a letter of recommendation. People like that are like amazing that they're there, and I was fortunate that I've had people like that in my life.
When you went there to Berkeley, had you ever left Los Angeles before?
No, that was it.
Yeah.
And in fact, I was scared to death because I didn't really know the rest of the world. And Berkeley is a great place, and so is the Bay Area. A whole world opened up to me that I didn't know. I think traveling away from your five blocks of your neighborhood is one of the best things for any gang kid or a biker kid stuck somewhere to do. Get away and get to see the world.
Yeah. Then from there, you go to San Bernardino and become a reporter.
Yeah, and San Bernardino was, I was surprised to know, was a really rough place. It still is somewhat, but man, it was rough in those days.
Yeah.
Second highest murder rate. Strict divisions between black, brown, and white. It was just a really rough, like I said, rootin' tootin' cowboy town. That's what it was in those days.
Brutal.
Very brutal. A lot of murders, a lot of deaths. And I, unfortunately, because I was already traumatized, was getting re-traumatized by being a crime reporter and seeing all the dead bodies, all the results of all the shootings and car accidents. I didn't know that I was being re-traumatized with all that stuff.
And coming down to Los Angeles, you work for a Mexican-American newspaper.
Yeah.
Writing poetry at the same time.
At the same time. And I think that was another one of my saving graces, that poetry was important for me.
Yeah.
Because it's very rare to find a writer that just wants to also do poetry. There's no money in poetry.
Don't.
You do it because you love it.
Yeah.
It's the only way to do it.
And then going to Germany with the group and traveling all over Europe.
Yeah.
I mean, again, when you talk, okay, you went to Berkeley, you'd never been out of L.A., but that had to be an eye-opener.
You know, the beautiful thing about finally getting into this world and the writing and journalism is that the world does open up.
Yeah.
And I've been to places I never in my wildest dreams would imagine. Germany, amazing, all of Europe that I was in. I've been to Japan, all over South America, Central America, Mexico. I mean, I've been to places that I never would have thought.
But that was where you said you slipped, because you had gotten dry.
Yeah.
I don't know whether it was AA or what helped you.
Yeah, I went to a recovery program, but I made the problem of thinking in a weird, unconscious way, I'm in another country, it's okay. I don't know, it's weird.
Yeah.
It was just me, my addiction, my addictive voice saying, hey, it's okay, any excuse.
Yeah.
And I felt really bad. I got very sick. I ended up having to come back and really get back into the recovery program because I was really in a bad way.
Yeah.
Lucky for me, and I always tell people that if you're going to relapse, just get back up, because relapse could be the worst thing or it could be the best thing.
Yeah.
In this case, it was a thing that finally kicked in, and I haven't drank since then.
Yeah. How did you kick heroin?
Cold turkey. The only way to do it in those days. People don't realize that in East LA and some of these poor neighborhoods, there was no recovery programs. There was no methadone. It wasn't. And cold turkey in the county jail, which is like, that's kind of weird. But it's interesting that the same guys that were going to sell me the drugs were the guys willing to help me.
Strange. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. In one pocket, out the other.
But I guess they saw, well, if you really don't want this, we don't want you either. I mean, it was a different time.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, oh, man, okay, we'll help you. We know how to do it.
What about when you went down to El Salvador to investigate how Crips and Bloods were going down into Central America?
Yeah.
And